there. And okay. See, it's casual, so, you know.
Recording, and I'm watching my language, or I'm being careful of using...
Yeah, profanity.
And vulgarity and so forth.
Yeah, for the sensitive listeners.
The hypocrisy of the UN definition on it, which is obvious what they were trying to do, is very typical of them. Exposing them for being hypocrites with that is probably about as much as you can do. I would not expect them, without any severe or major representation from multiple countries, to ever change anything like that, because their agenda is obvious what it is. It's from the beginning, you know, not just from the League of Nations, but later on from the United Nations, which I believe was a term coined by the Soviet Union. It's against us. It's against regionalism. It's against localism. It's against nationalism, certainly. It's against...
But the funny thing is, when you read the definition of what they consider, like, I have a definition here, 2003 version, University of Minnesota Human Rights Center, and this is what it says. Introduction. Who are indigenous peoples? People who inhabited a land before it was conquered by colonial societies and who consider themselves distinct from the societies currently governing those territories are called indigenous peoples.
Right. So yeah. what that would mean that the Japanese, who are largely descended from people who were native to the Korean Peninsula and Siberia, are not native Japanese. They're not indigenous Japanese, only the Ainu are. Yeah. You know, this would mean that the people of Singapore, not the Chinese who dominate Singapore economically and socially and politically, are, you know, the only indigenous so-called people there.
Yeah.
It would mean that modern Turkey is not populated by indigenous people either, because the Turks are from Central Asia, at least the Turkish language, and the, you know, designation Turkic is Central Asian. It's not Anatolian. So it's, you know, it's a rather strange thing. Of course, they mean to apply it to the former European colonial area. And this would make it very difficult. So you would have a tough time saying that. Now, maybe, you know, it'd be interesting to say, well, okay, you know, would you be able to say that England, for instance, was colonized by Romans and then by, you know, various groups from the continent, and therefore only Picts and so forth are indigenous, you know, to England or something?
Yeah, that's one white population able to perhaps make that case.
Yeah, only against another white population, though, you know, who is less.
But still, they are an ethnic group, you know.
So yes, they are. I don't know
in their case. But Martinez Cobo, 1984, said, and this is also interesting: those which having a historical continuity with pre-invasion and pre-colonial societies that developed on their territories consider themselves distinct from other sectors of societies now prevailing in those territories or parts of them. They form at present non-dominant sectors of society and are determined to preserve, develop, and transmit to future generations their ancestral territories and their ethnic identity as the basis of their continued existence as peoples in accordance with their own cultural patterns, social institutions, and legal systems. So again, you have the talk here about pre-invasions, pre-colonial societies. And again, who did most of the colonializing? Well,
what about if you said that pagans...
about white people when we hear that?
What if you would say you could spin this, not that it's going to get a UN resolution. I don't expect anything decent from the UN ever, only to be able to point out their hypocrisy and make a big deal out of that. You know, it's about as much as you can ask for and get a larger and larger audience for this. But what about people who adopted a traditionalist European pagan society and said that either the modern globalist secularism has colonized me, or you could even say that Christianity has done it.
Yeah, it's like also true.
Exactly, and you would have a bulletproof argument there, an airtight argument. But, you know, are you going to get a resolution on this? No, but it would certainly be good to have them, you know, make up a bunch of ridiculous reasons why that wasn't applicable, which is exactly what they would try to do.
Yeah.
And say, oh, but there's no historical continuity is what they would try to do. I can tell you right now, because they're simple. They're not very creative. You know how they're going to think next. It's obvious. They've done it so many times exactly the same way.
But the thing is, there is a definition of what indigenous is.
Yes.
And it is, you know, in contrast to what they talk about in the human rights, the free dictionary.
Yes, they're violating their own definitions.
Like here, the American Heritage Dictionary of English Language, 4th edition, copyright, yada yada yada.
This is the
they state that an indigenous people or whatever is intrinsic, innate, originating, and right. or and living, or occurring naturally in an environment.
Hey, no geographer, no ethnographer. No zoologist talking about an indigenous population, for that matter, would be able to maintain the definition contradiction that they have between what is indigenous in the UN legally.
Exactly.
And
because we can point out where whites originate, and that would be Europe. For example, we have von Lusken's chromatic scale, the map of indigenous skin color distribution in the world.
Right.
You know, we can find out when and where the lighter melanin genes developed, the SLC24A5 gene, was discovered 6,000 to 10,000 years ago in both Europe and Asia.
Where does that frequent on? Where is that?
It's both in Europe and Asia. You know... But there's a difference between the melanin levels.
Right.
Europe has a lighter melanin level than, say, Asia. So, it's specific to Europe, looking at this map here. Then there's actually a study by, let's see, what is their name? Petros Dryneas and Jamie Lewis and Peristera Pascal or something, inferring geographic coordinates of origin for Europeans using small panels of ancestry information markers, where they essentially concluded that they could pinpoint individuals, Europeans, phenotypical Europeans, to the geographic origin of Europe. And you can look at human mtDNA migrations, and we can see that on these maps where certain markers developed and where they're originated and so forth, and that would be Europe. There's different maps. There's one by DNA testing center, gene tree, YDNA haplogroup migration patterns. It shows that certain markers here are common in Europe. As far back as 40,000 years ago. So I mean, it's ridiculous. You can track back like the European genes or whatever that people who look European phenotypically. You can track that back tens and thousands of years ago to these lands. That is to say, following the definition of indigenous,
right.
originating and living. Occurring naturally in an area or environment. That's where we live. And they give an example here of indigenous. For example, black bear. The black bear is indigenous to... the American black bear is indigenous to many different parts of North America. Well, this applies to humans as well. And native...
It's different in the East and the West. They're distinguishable. Western black bears and Eastern black bears are different. Eastern black bears are smaller. They have different temperaments. There's lots
And the word native is a synonym for indigenous. And native means existing in or belonging to one by nature, innate. Being such by birth or origin. Being one's own because of the place or circumstance of one's birth. Well, that's not really applicable here. Originating, growing, or produced in a certain place, region, indigenous, being a member of the original inhabitants of a particular place, that's applicable, archaic, closely related as birth or race. That's as specific as it gets, I suppose. Other synonyms are aboriginal, and antonyms are foreign, strange, and non-native, not being or composed of aborigines. For example, the non-native population of South Africa. Looking at the definition of indigenous and native, and then looking at genetic markers maps, or whatever you want to call them, haplogroup maps, we can know that white people, and everyone knows what we're talking about then, that they do come from the European countries, that they do originate from those lands, and thereby they are indigenous, thereby they are native, thereby they are aboriginals to European countries, at least now, European countries.
Yes, they've developed their phenotypes and their peculiarities. We have developed ours on those lands.
Exactly.
The mistake to say that we developed them somewhere else and then moved there, in which case you beg the question. I've heard that blue eyes are first, the gene for blue eyes is first found, it's not first found, but it's found most frequently and therefore seems to originate somewhere north of the Caspian Sea, I believe it is.
Yeah.
Kind of in that Kurgan area. That doesn't necessarily mean everybody with blue eyes, though, is native to that particular part of the world. There'll be a lot of people claiming that as their homeland. Especially the development of the Nordic type is very strongly indigenous to where it is to northwestern Europe. I mean, that's not a type other than in the Latvia and Estonia, somewhere in the Balkan areas. Not so much Lithuania, even. You don't see that type out of that region, you know. Not the Slavics have this look as well. Many of the northern Slavs. And they more or less get it from that whole Balkan region.
Yeah.
So this is very true. There are also a lot of groups worldwide that would not be considered indigenous in areas that they live. You know, this could be used against the Bantu, who have recently spread all over large parts of Africa and displaced indigenous people there.
Exactly. The Bantu are not natives to South Africa.
They're native to the Congo region, to the deep tropics, very deep central Africa. And some of the mountainous regions around Rwanda and so forth.
Yeah. Now, I would, of course, like, if I could pick one, the Bantu or the white Afrikaner, and if I had to choose which one I would assume belongs or is native to the South African country, I would, of course, assume the Bantu, because the Bantu is obviously more genetically and phenotypically close to the Xhosa.
Yeah, but the Xhosa may actually be, I don't know if how well this has been figured out. I'm sure it has. You know, the Xhosa or the San are most typical of the group that actually left Africa and diverged into all of the rest of the world's populations.
Yeah, I've heard they're the oldest one.
And so it's not just that they're the oldest so much, it's that their line is the one that moved into, you know, Southern Arabia and then along the Arabian Gulf and or Sea and then towards India and on and on.
Mm.
And there may be more genetic similarity. At least it depends on what markers you're looking at, and I'm not going to sit here and try and pretend I have them all in my head, you know. It may be that the San are closer to, for instance, people of Asia and Europe because of this than the Bantu are, except where there's been mixing with people who are, you know, distinct from the Bantu. And it may also be that the Yoruba and the Bantu are more distant from each other, even though because of living in the same kind of environments or more similar environments, there are distinctions between them. You can notice them, but they still look more alike than, for instance, we do with any of them.
Yeah.
Or even that we do with South Asians, you know. But nonetheless, we are definitely closer to South Asians in terms of genealogy than the Bantu are to the Yoruba, or either one is to the San. And we may be closer to the San. So we may be closer to the indigenous inhabitants by genealogy, and I'm sure by marker as well, of large parts of Africa than we are to the people who have colonized them subsequently. Furthermore, you know, Afrikaners were in parts of South Africa that were uninhabited. And whether there were any sand there before or not is a hard one to say, because they didn't leave a lot in the way of archaeological remains.
Yeah.
So there's, you know, lots of inconsistencies if you try to say that somehow that, you know, native rule of South Africa means letting the Bantu run the show. That just doesn't really make sense based on any of these definitions or any analysis that you can adequately defend, you know?
Yeah. So the point is that the UN's definition of indigenous peoples is very inconsistent with the definition of what is indigenous and native.
And I think it seems like in the definition they saw some of these things coming at least a little bit.
And I kind of feel that they were trying to, like, deliberately ensure that this couldn't apply to whites.
Yes, this is very obvious. They did a very rudimentary, but in their way, careful job. That's about as good as they can do.
Yeah.
Of trying to exclude us at the time that they wrote this. Oh no, we're going to have indigenous Europeans claiming that they're going to swamped, because that argument.
Secession movements.
Yeah, absolutely, and independence movements and indigenous rights movements. I mean, you know, the one thing that they would be most terrified of would be some kind of coordinated and large scale indigenous rights movement amongst Nords and Alpinids and other groups of continental and northern Europe.
Yeah.
I don't think they even be as nervous about a movement of indigenous Picts claiming that they have been colonized by Romans and Christians and Angles and Saxons, or not in that order, but that probably would not scare them nearly as much.
But
they're motivated, and they're not worried about being inconsistent with their logic either. That's the nature of legalese. You just define it to be something, and then you ignore the fact that the truth is something else. And, you know, this happens in other cases in Europe. We won't get into those right now, but when you say the truth is no defense, I think a lot of people will know exactly what that references to.
Yeah.
And this is, you know, this is the nature of that beast, but pointing out their hypocrisy is certainly a good thing to do. It's at least make them look like who they are. What is the YouTuber, Ryan Dawson, he says, always force a dictatorship to act like one. You know, I think that's a good point. Always force
make
them,
it explicit.
Obviously. Force a hypocrite to look like a hypocrite. Force a liar to look like a liar.
That's kind of what I like with this whole Bob Whitaker mantra. To actually get anti-racists to acknowledge that their values are, in essence, against whites. Prescriptive whites, that is to say. Whites who care about being white and who identify with whiteness or whatever. You know what I mean?
Yes, absolutely.
Because it's like a very gratifying feeling when you comment on YouTube and you engage with one of these people in a conversation, and they admit that they are anti-white. There's the people that try to, like, backtrack and make excuses and say, oh no, I'm not anti-white, and that's good as well. I mean, you keep them on the defense, that's very good. But you have the anti-whites that acknowledge that, yes, I am anti-white, you know, I am. And yes. That's, you know, thank you, you're just being honest.
They should all have to sound like that crazy guy that said he's going to eat white babies or something. Remember, was it 2 years ago or so, the guy that said...
Black Panther.
You want freedom, you're going to have to kill some crackers.
Yeah.
You know, make them all sound like him, you know, and that's...
Yeah, we're as close to it as possible.
Certainly.
To
become very nervous about the whole being cornered about this, and they don't want to say they're anti-white, and they don't want to say that... they're not anti-white, and they start saying, well, now, you know, I'm pro-human, you know, I'm pro-everybody, I'm for everybody, you know, but they don't want to make distinctions between groups of people when it benefits whites, and so they're not a nationalist saying I'm for everybody who's consistent.
Yeah.
It says, yes, but I believe that these people are distinct because it's obvious that they are, and they think that they are, and only in cases of political convenience does that get any kind of mitigation, and therefore, and they're only for the instance at hand. So... if people who are trying to take this, I'm pro the whole universe thing, you know, black holes and supernovas and everything in between, then you make them look really nebulous, and that really discredits them as well. Because you say, okay, well, if you're pro everybody, then if you think everybody should mix, then you have no problem with Tibetans being drowned out by Chinese, or the people of Malaysia, for instance, having this issue, or the, you know, you
well,
can...
alternatively, if they're pro-human, then mm-hmm. I suppose they're pro-individuals, and if they're pro-individuals, then individuals have the right to be around whoever they want to.
Absolutely, good point.
So, yep. I mean, in any way you cut or slice this, it will always come back and, you know, bite them.
Yes, they can't be pro-self-implode. Anti-individual.
Yeah.
You know, this they might try to figure that out. I think the left is going through many decades of trying to figure that one out.
Yeah, but how to, like, their idea is self-implode. The idea is to point it out. The idea is to... like you said, with Ryan Dawson, I believe his name was, to really emphasize that they're authoritarian.
Force them to play their hand.
Yeah.
Make them show their hand.
Because they always want to play the moral card.
Yeah.
That they're on the high horse, the moral high horse, the moral high ground or whatever. And you want to take that away from them, because then they lose. Because that's essentially all they got. The emotional rhetoric... that's all they rely on for the most part.
And when they get desperate, they resort to censorship and character assassination and defaming people when they have power. And when they don't have power, they just resort to name calling and screaming and hiding eventually.
Yeah.
And those are, you know, worthwhile scenarios to have to push them through. For those in power, it can be a dangerous case, and in other periods in time in the world it has been, to force people to play that hand because they have had power, and in their desperation they use it in very destructive ways. But nonetheless, that does collapse. Now, you know, not many people want to be the one to get sacrificed to that cause, but it's sometimes necessary, and you have to pick the battles wisely. We're not really as much at that point as there have been points like this, for instance, in communist East Europe. You know, if you were found to be anti anything that could have got you labeled a fascist, a capitalist, any of these things, and you could have just been a Christian and that would have happened to you.
Yeah.
Things have been very, very bad, very bad. Under Dej or Ceausescu or one of these dictators, you know, you would have faced a nasty situation. So, you know, as long as we still have the ability to force them into these corners where they have to make contradictions or deny that they hold certain positions. This is what they like to do to us. You know, they like to find a comment that we've made or something. If the ones who...
Blow it out of proportion?
Yeah, and then force us to backtrack and say, oh, no, but I didn't mean that. Oh, no, but I didn't... You know, this is what they love to have us do. Like Ramsey Paul says, you know, in public, they like to call it the white man's... Or they like to get the white man to grovel. He calls it, they like to have him do the white man. Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, I didn't mean to say that. Oh, no. No, that's not what I meant. Oh, I didn't mean to offend anybody. You know?
By the way, you know what I love? I love the fact that this whole mantra, anti-racism is anti-white, their counter-criticism or their counter-argument to that mantra is that it is parroting. It is, you know, the persons that are using the mantra are just tools, and it's deflecting criticism. And so on and so forth. That's essentially their arguments. But it hasn't crossed their mind that the words that they so frequently use and have been using, like racist, Nazi, fascist, all these words, they carry the same function. Exactly. They carry the same function. So they, like a lot of the people that use this mantra, anti-racism is anti-white, they're conscious of the effect. They know that that's our way of that's our way of saying racist. That's our way of calling them fascist. That's
right.
Our way of calling them Nazis or whatever.
Yeah.
To cause the same emotional response that racism, Nazism, and fascism has cost us in the past.
Yeah.
But we're intelligent enough to realize that. But in their criticism, they're dumb enough to not get that the same criticism that they apply to us because we use that word, they could apply to themselves when they use the word racist, Nazi, fascist, and so on and so forth. That's something I find quite interesting.
The left has always been scared of this. Their own deconstructionist methods can be turned against them.
Yeah.
Their own rejection of everything orthodox, once they become the orthodox, can and will be used against them. And they've, you know, fought with this for a while. This is why censorship campaigns are so, you know, prominent amongst the, if you look at leftist countries historically. I mean, that was just the biggest thing they went on a binge and a purge doing, was censoring everything and anything that might possibly throw their hypocrisy into some sort of light. And, you know, words like fascist and racist and the associations that they use, actually, they would have said chauvinistic or something. And,
bourgeoisie. You
know, yeah, bourgeois capital. And it could be just because you were even a Christian, you know, and a lot of the Christians, they don't seem to understand. It's almost a leftist that they don't know the history of their own rhetoric. They just buy, they just use it. They don't know where it comes from. They don't know how many dictators gave speeches where they stood up there and said chauvinistic, nationalist, bourgeois, capitalist, fascist, all in the same sentence hundreds of times, you know.
Yeah.
And this was what they basically did whenever, you know, the rulers, the dictators of communist countries in the 30s or 40s or 50s, early 40s, 50s, 60s gave speeches. This is exactly what they would do. This was what Ceausescu was doing when he was finally chased out of his building and flew off in the helicopter with the Securitate. He was giving a speech just like the modern leftists do in a much smaller and less significant way on YouTube. They're just paying no attention to reality or fact. You know, they're just they're judging fake fruit at the fruit stand, basically, you know.
Yeah.
I like to compare them to their predecessors, of whom they're rather unaware of.
And by the way,
rather watered down version of.
The quote by that I mentioned earlier by Martinez Cobo in 1984, I can just read parts of it again. Those which, having a historical continuity with pre-invasion and pre-colonial societies that develop on their territories, consider themselves distinct from other sectors of societies now prevailing in those territories or parts of them, the former and present non-dominant sectors of society. This deals with what is indigenous, what constitutes an indigenous people. So those which having a historical continuity with pre-invasion and pre-colonial. Okay, pre-colonial. And then, let's see here. They form at present non-dominant sectors. They form at present non-dominant sectors.
Right.
That means, that is to say, for whites to be called indigenous, we have to be both colonialized,
mm-hmm.
and we have to both become non-dominant. Here's the problem.
They're indigenous to Detroit, and they've been colonized.
Here's the problem. In South Africa, for an example, the minorities are called the dominant minority.
Right, right.
So how on earth did you escape this? For example, men are minorities compared to women, but men are called the dominant minority. So you can't escape that. For example, white Britons will become minorities in 2066. So what, should we wait until 2066 until we can start to be concerned about, you know, whites whites having the same rights as other indigenous peoples, or white Americans in 2042, or non-whites in general will be majority in U.S. and Europe by 2050. This is according to The Guardians and The Telegraph.
Probably not going to happen, but that's because of other reasons that are beyond their control. I've already, you know, stated that before, but nonetheless, it is at the moment going in that direction pretty severely. I think Whitaker's pointed that out as well, where he says that, you know, in Africa, the anti-colonial rhetoric, especially in South Africa, maybe not in all of the anti-colonial movements, was majority rule, majority rule.
Yeah.
And this has been a mantra even used in Iraq, which justified, you know, the deposing of the Sunni government, the Ba'athist government, and allowing the Shiites of Iraq to have a larger position in the political sphere there. And it was only like a 45-55 split. Not quite, because there's the Kurds and a few other ethnic minorities there.
Mm-hmm.
Quote, unquote. But, you know, he's pointed this out, that majority rule seems to be the mantra there, and then all of a sudden it's, oh, minority rights and civil rights is the mantra, you know, wherever. It's just what convenience of whatever makes it harder for the white guy.
Yeah.
I mean, it's very obvious that that's what it is. You can't really spin it any other way.
No.
And you get lots of inflamed and inarticulate comments when you point that out to people. You know, they'll say, oh, but historically these people have been so, you know, oppressed and subjected and blah, blah, blah. And then you start giving them examples from other parts of the world that don't even have white people involved on either side. And it seems like it's unimportant to them, you know?
Yeah.
You know, did the Native American groups of the Ohio Valley, who were much stronger politically in the Mississippi Valley, did they colonize some of their neighbors? Well, yeah. I mean, where they wanted something, they took it if they were able to. The Aztecs, you know, in the Incas, and this is a very good example of where they had pissed off their neighbors so bad by doing far worse than colonizing them that their neighbors in many cases joined the Europeans, Cortez or Pizarro or whoever. So, you know, these aren't very excitable to them. Most of the people who are anti-white don't really start screaming and calling you a fascist when you mention those examples. It's only where whites are involved. Which, you know, this says something about the human brain and its ability to accept programming. I don't know. Do they have, like I said, it's almost in some cases like they have, especially the white ones, some kind of a version of a Capgras syndrome.
Yeah.
That's not my race. That's not my arm. That's not my mother. Well, it looks just like her. Yeah, but it's not. You know, it's an imposter. The white man's an imposter. But you're white. Well, you're a fascist.
Denying the ancestors or the lineage, denying the family in a sense, rebelling against the family.
And the thing is, they don't get respect from the other groups that they're trying to ingratiate themselves to. I think that's something that they really need to understand. You know, nobody's, you know, I don't have the positions I have out of hatred towards anybody.
Mm.
And I've grown up in situations where I was one of the few whites around, and I actually appreciated a lot of the experiences that I had. And when I was young, many of them were very good, you know.
Yeah.
And there's no hatred that I have for any other group of people. I don't like certain tendencies in certain groups. And this is the truth. There are certain tendencies in my own I get nervous and frustrated with, such as this universalist kind of all-embracing tendency, which really goes way back for a lot of reasons in evolution of our people. But it's there, you know, and I have to love the best things about it. You know, it's just something to watch for. But to be honest about tendencies and traits and how they're going to conflict with each other has nothing to do with being, you know, antagonistic or hateful. So that doesn't hold up. But furthermore, you don't win anybody's respect anywhere by being a pushover and just, oh, I'll take your side against my own anytime, guys. I mean, they might like that. They might laugh. But when you're not there, they consider you absolutely garbage.
I actually have a friend that functioned just like that. He always takes the side of non-whites, and as soon as he is attempting to be funny, attempting to make a humorous remark or whatever, it's always some form of, aren't whites racist, or aren't whites stupid, oh, typical whites, ha ha ha. It's always against whites, and I guess it's because we've been taught that we can't say anything bad about other people, we can only attack our own. But simultaneously, non-whites have been taught that it's okay to make fun of white people. So it's like when it comes to stereotypes or when it comes to racial issues and so on, it's always okay to mock the white man, regardless if you're white or non-white.
Right. And the more white you are, the closer to white you are by phenotype, or not even, but maybe just by skin color. The more you can't make fun of those who are, you know, a little bit darker. So in other words, if Chinese make fun of Africans, you know, this will be considered a very racist kind of taboo thing, you know, like at the Olympics, I think there was an incident along these lines. But if Africans make fun of the Chinese, it's not as big a deal. You know, it's like, that's kind of funny, you know.
Well, that's cultural Marxism.
Yes.
Straight up. That's just, that's what it is. Blacks are further down. They're considered more depressed.
Right, which means cultural Marxism.
Which means that they ought to have more cultural power.
In cultural Marxism, in doing that, makes the most racist assumption of all. It's funny, for all of the, you know, names that we get called that stem from some sort of hereditarianism, implicit in a lot of their polemics is that blacks are on the lowest position on the ladder now and forever.
Because otherwise, that's the thing. It's like a lot of the anti-racists, they kind of treat the especially blacks, like they're incapable of taking care of themselves.
Yes,
like they need our help. I can actually consider them as a legit political threat. And I don't mean that I view every individual as a threat or that I view their people as a threat. I mean politically. I know that they are capable of power, that they are capable of achieving things that will that can have a huge impact, whether negatively or positively. But it can have a huge impact, and it can have a huge negative impact. And I'm aware of that. I acknowledge that. But in the mind of the anti-racist or whatever you want to call them, it's like they deny that blacks are capable of doing wrong and that they're incapable of having power over whites. And that's
very
dangerous.
They're incapable of doing anything at all, it seems. They think that if they're not holding the black person's hand and handing them something from somebody else that they've taken by a political extortion, that this black person is just going to die, you know. You would think that they would have made it this far in evolution without these leftists there to, you know, to pamper them and to shame their own people and say, how dare you be so oppressive to this poor person here? We're going to take all your stuff and give it to them to make things equal. I mean, if they're not doing that, they just think, you know, these other groups just have no chance whatsoever, which is why they're inherently very antagonistic towards libertarian ideals.
Yeah.
Because they think, oh, God, if you take all of this away and let everybody stand on their own, why these poor people will all fall? They'll all just collapse. They won't have any chance whatsoever. And nothing could be further from the truth. They actually did better at times where they weren't being taken care of so much, you know.
I know.
You leave them a little bit alone, even when they were forced into positions where they were alone or forced into situations where they were not allowed to interchange economically and politically with whites. They actually had a bit more of a stratified and therefore a more functional society amongst themselves. Of course, the left is against stratification, too. Inherently in distinction there. So even if you have a minority group that has stratification within itself, which every complex society is going to have, it's endemic. You can't get away from that. That's nature. That's how things are arranged. You know, you're going to have stratification. They don't like that, but they of course won't focus on that right now because it's not the big deal to them. But yeah, they don't think that these groups can do anything at all on their own. They have to be there to help them, you know, and otherwise they don't validate themselves, which shows a kind of a psychological neediness amongst them, the anti-racists, that if I'm not validated by these other people, I just don't feel like I'm doing it, like I'm worthy of existence, you know. But the last thing, then they don't want validity from their own. They reject that and denounce that.
Yeah, I know. Speaking about that, here's a thought that I've been thinking about. I don't know if you can make this case or not. It's very subjective, I suppose. But I would like to make a distinction within, well, essentially any people, really. I mean, Native Americans, Tibetans, whites, whatever. It doesn't matter. Prescriptive and descriptive. You have the Tibetans that are descriptively Tibetans. That is to say, they're Tibetans in name and in name only. Yeah, I'm Tibetan, you know, by nationality, sure. But I don't ascribe it any value. Or yeah, I'm Tibetan by appearance, like I'm part of the Mongoloid phenotype. But they don't ascribe it any value. Then you have the prescriptive Tibetans. That is to say, the Tibetans that do ascribe it more value than just being a name or just being appearance. They identify with being Tibetan. It's a part of their identity. In a similar vein, you have like prescriptive whites and Poles versus descriptive whites and Poles, for example, using Poland as an example.
Right.
And then you have whites and Poles who are white or Polish in description only, in name and appearance only. Whites and Poles who are more than white and Polish in description only, and whose identity is white and or Polish. So that's the difference between, I believe, an anti-racist or whatever they want to call themselves, anti-white, I don't care, and a so-called racist white person or a racist Polish person. There's the Polish individuals that, you know, yeah, sure, I was born in Poland, yeah, sure, by nationality I'm Polish, but I don't care. So what I think is that, or what I would argue is that, it is of course the prescriptive native or aboriginal indigenous or native persons that only can identify with or care about and experience the struggle of their people. is not the descriptive individuals. It is the prescriptive individuals. So in a similar vein, for example, those blacks during slavery who were known as Uncle Toms, they can, of course, not be said to speak on behalf of those slaves who had a negative experience in regards to slavery. And likewise, those Native Americans that welcomed the white settlers can likewise not be said to speak on the behalf of those Indians who had a negative experience in regards to the immigration of the white settlers. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think this is an important distinction to include in the language, because by making that distinction, you can make a distinction between, in a sense, you can save the argument of this whole discussion of genocide and what is indigenous, what is native, and so on and so forth. Because you're obviously going to have the majority of Germans and the majority of French people, the majority of British people, so far in present time, being fine with immigration, being fine with implementing political policies or continuing to vote for political policies that are detrimental to the demographics of whites and the ability of whites to pursue ethnic self-determination. And that's the descriptive whites, those that just are white by, you know, acknowledging that, yeah, sure, I look in a certain way, but I don't care about it. I don't ascribe it any value. Sure, I am British by nationality on paper, but I don't care about it. I don't ascribe it any value. I don't think they have a right, or I don't think they have a right to say anything in regards to the struggle that prescriptive British people or prescriptive French people feel in regards to what is currently going on. And perhaps, I don't know if you have any thoughts on this, but other than that, I just think it's an interesting idea. I think it's important to add this in the discourse.
Yeah, I think there's, you know, obviously there's some nuance there. You have some people who will go along with a certain political party and agenda almost out of just habit. You know, you have a lot of this in England where people will vote Labour or, you know, Tory for reasons that are just their grandparents did it, you know, because it stood for a whole different thing at that time. So you have some that are descriptive, certainly in behavior they fall into that, and it's a good behavioral distinction. I mean, there's agendas behind some of it that are different. You have some people that are, of course, white and they're bothered by things, but they just feel like they better go along with it for now because it's a safer thing to do.
Yeah.
You know, certainly anyone who's had dictatorships in their history in recent history in the last 100 years realizes that, you know, that was a survival strategy in many cases. You didn't believe it, but you sure as hell went along with it because you knew what would happen if you didn't, or if later on you were found out not to have.
Yeah, ostracization from the group. Yeah. Been very, very dangerous.
Sure, people who just are, you know, going to say, oh, well, I just go, for whatever reason, you just, you know, completely go along with it. You know, you're not going to be given the kind of, your statements and your considerations of your own aren't going to be given the gravity of someone who actually really cares and therefore is aware of the problems that you're facing, as well as the inconsistencies in the rationale for those problems and the acceptance of them.
Well, what I mean is that it doesn't matter, like, percentage-wise, how many British people that oppose what is going on. It could just be 2% of the British people that dislike what is going on. And they would still have a right to claim that it is genocide. They would still, if it fits the definition.
Right. It's not genocide because the rest of these guys don't mind being slaughtered and replaced.
Exactly. And that's because, not only because, you know, the other people, that there might be psychological causes like conformity, or perhaps they haven't rationalized this, perhaps they haven't spent time thinking about what is going on, whatever. It's irrelevant. The point is, it is prescriptive Tibetans. It is prescriptive Africans. It is prescriptive whites that are the interesting party here, not whites in general, not, and definitely not the masses, whites or Tibetans that are purely descriptive whites or Tibetans.
The masses are not very interesting, I have to agree.
Yeah. That's essentially the something that I think is important. I don't know what this is. I came across something, another thing here that I thought was quite funny in regards to genocide. I don't know where I got this from, but by studying all known genocides, they conclude that there are 8 essential steps to genocide. And the first step is classification. So, are whites being classified? Well, of course, prescriptive whites are being classified. That is to say, whites who care about being white, who ascribe it more value than just saying, yeah, sure, I'm white in appearance.
Oh,
well, they're obviously called racist, Nazi, fascist. I mean, anyone who is white, who wants or survives a people, is branded racist, Nazi.
Right.
So that's a classification. Second, symbolization. Well, what are the anti-racist or the anti-whites usually branding us with kind of symbols? Well, the swastika. We're branded with a swastika next to our face if we show our face. Doesn't right. matter if it is the BNP Nick Griffin or if it is Jared Taylor or whoever. Right. They get branded with a swastika. That's symbolization. Third point right. here is dehumanization. Well, we're essentially argued as being, you know, evil, violent monsters and morons. We're either greedy, white, privileged Nazis or something, or we're hillbillies. So that's dehumanization, obviously. So far it fails the point of classification, symbolization, dehumanization. Then there's organization. Well, race theory, affirmative action, etc. Institutionalizing race-biased systems. Applying hate crime laws so that whites can be charged for committing hate crimes, but hate crime cannot be committed against whites. The whole welfare system, for example, in Sweden, and immigrants, that is to say non-indigenous Swedes, actually get more welfare. They get more benefits. Pro-immigration classes and seminars, for example, a couple of days ago I saw, and this is paid by taxpayers' money, they actually have pro-immigration seminars. I forgot what his name is now. Al Sharpton, I believe it's called.
Oh, good Lord. Yes, Al Sharpton, of course.
Yeah, he was actually in Sweden. Again, I don't know if it's Jesse Jackson or Al Sharpton. I always confuse those two. They're the same idiots.
Jesse is even uglier.
Okay. Well, I guess it's Al Sharpton. I don't know. But he was in Sweden again. And this was like a pro-immigration class paid by Swedish indigenous taxpayer money. So, but this is organization. I mean, they're promoting, they're trying to come up with ideas. They're trying to use thinkers to justify more immigrants, which has all kind of negative consequences for indigenous whites. So that's...
Yes, they bring in absolutely the most vile and unreasonable and absolutely discredited people that they can. I mean, Sharpton, you know, has a little bit more audience here, and it's changed, but Jackson gets almost no consideration whatsoever in the United States, even amongst blacks.
Okay.
So, you know, to have him brought into Sweden to talk to Swedes like this yeah. is disgusting, and whoever did that knew what they were doing.
Sure.
They, you know, I'm sure it wasn't him. He is not the one who organized that. And I can sit here and speculate on what group might have organized that or had something to do with it. And, you know, they must have thought to themselves, oh, let's bring in the biggest idiot, the most discredited, stereotypical ass that we can and inflict that upon the Swedish people as almost some sort of sadism on their part, you know, because Jackson gets no consideration here whatsoever.
Well, if you look now, we're obviously politically correct, and when you look into the politically correct system from the outside, having breaking off the chains of political correctness, looking inside this bubble, I'm not sure the masses are really realizing the idiocy of what they're talking about. For example, there was a cop there. She was a Swede, this cop. And she held hate crime classes for school children, where essentially the villain was always the white man or whatever. And she explicitly acknowledged that only whites can commit hate crime, essentially. But whites can never be, hate crimes can never be done to whites. She actually acknowledged this and talked openly about this as if it's a good thing. And all it took for someone to be charged with a hate crime was, for example, if someone was Muslim and the other partner was Swedish, and the Muslim felt offended and there was a crime involved, I don't know, stealing or, I don't know, pushing him so he fell to the ground or whatever, physical violence, I suppose that could be called. If he felt offended and race or religion was in the picture, then it's a hate crime. He will get punished more. And she talked about that for about half an hour, went into great detail about this, and she talked about it as if it was something positive. Now, I'm sure from inside this politically correct bubble, I guess it is, but looking from the outside in, it's just insanity. That's not fair.
Now, this lady has cop grass syndrome, and she's very happy that someone is smashing her unwanted arm that she doesn't accept that she owns with a hammer.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, she's saying, that's not my arm. That's an imposter. Well, I don't know how it got there, but it just does its own thing. And somebody said, well, let me smash it then with this sledgehammer. And she says, oh, well, that would be very well. I wish you would do that, because I don't know whose it is anyway. I mean, you know, this is a mental patient. She needs to be, you know, getting MRI scans of her brain and going through deep psychiatric evaluation. Of course, the majority of psychiatrists would not be evaluating her properly because they may have similar agendas. But this is a mental patient, basically. This is someone who is so disconnected from anything observable or objective or reasonable or defensible.
Xenophilic.
It's xenophilic, but she's beyond just xenophile. She's got some sort of deep, you know, something like an aphasia or something like that, but it's a very, very, very big problem for her brain, or for the rest of our bodies, in other words, you know, for our asses, because the fact that she is so sure about this and that other people buy into this, it says a lot about the...
But it's the whole thing of why, I mean, her political views obviously decreases social and cultural power for her. Or for her in-group,
A political ideology that cultivates and promotes mental disease, basically. Yeah. Psychological disease. You have a culture of racial cop grass patients, you know? I'd have to call Villanaya Ramachandran on voicemail and leave him a bunch of messages until he wonders who the hell is this guy and gets back to me and say, man, I've got one here for you. This beats phantom limb syndrome any day. Now you've got, you know, phantom race syndrome, but you've got people rejecting the group that they belong to so much that they want to see them absolutely defenseless.
And that is true because they are authoritarian. They're against their ability to have any slight chance of opting out from these detrimental political policies. By secession, okay. By, I don't know. That's another thing I was interested in talking about. Maybe we can go into that later on, but reservations and stuff.
Well. Yeah, it's a secession. The thing that is very strange about that, other than the fact that it's a disease, that's not strange, is how easy it is to get people to adopt this kind of destructive mentality now that this lady obviously exemplifies. Yeah. Because in the past, in communist regimes, I like to keep going back to communist East Europe, you know, it's a great example of where you had a very raw, brutal, unmitigated and just explicit, graphic kind of depiction of mental re-education, as they would call it.
Yeah.
In order to get people to adopt the kind of mentality that this lady had, we'll use her for an example, they had to use incredibly brutal tactics. You know, in reading a book about the communist Romania, Dej, who before Ceausescu, who was more brutal, actually, would, you know, had they, there were these prisons, and one of them was, I think, called Potesi, or I think I've got the name right, and a guy named Trocanow, I believe, I have to look at the book and see what his name was, Trocanow, actually, was over these re-education programs. And to basically get people to go along with the state policy at this point, they would do things like have best friends torture each other, beat each other. You know, they would get people who they knew were close to each other outside of the prison that they've now been put in for being, I don't know, former Iron Guard members or something, okay, whatever they trumped up. And they would put them through this horrendous thing. You know, they'd make one guy might force the other one to clean the floor with a rag in his teeth, you know, and his hands bound behind his back, and it just awful things like this. And they would endure severe beatings, and they would make suicide almost impossible. They would take any kind of cutlery away. You know, people try to throw themselves down stairwells. That was how desperate they were to commit suicide. They didn't know how else to try and do it. And, you know, it was through programs that were that graphic. I could read some of them at a later time. It's pretty fascinating. They were able to achieve this kind of broken human being that just, you know, doesn't care about anything, is completely detached. Anytime somebody would eat, they would inflict pain on them. So they would associate formerly pleasurable sensations and response to basic biological needs with pain and suffering. So everything was just screwed up in their brain as much as possible through very brutal methods. And yet this lady has, you know, adopted a policy. It's not so graphically destructive, but effectively it's every bit as destructive. It's a very twisted kind of psychology that she has. And yet I would suggest that she wasn't tortured, that she didn't have to go through any of this in order to adopt this insanity or possess this insanity or be inflicted of this kind of self-destructive mentality. You know, she seems to be very happy about it, just like the member of the Securitate or whoever, NKVD or some other group might have been happy about their position in their government job. But the way to achieve this now is done slowly and through lots of suggestion at a level that doesn't require the prison camps and the torture and the re-education program.
Well, that's where doublespeak, newspeak, and conformity and all these comes into the picture, where control over the language, conditioning, socializing, all of this comes into the picture. I know also in the former Soviet Union, not everything was as graphic as it was, as you say, in Romania. You had a lot of I don't know, psychologizing, is that the right term? No, pathologizing is the term. They try to ascribe everything as a disease. For example, if you disagree with their political policies, you're applied some kind of an ism. An ism that implies that you are insane and you have to go to the mental hospital.
Right, which is where I said this lady ought to go.
Yeah, well, no, I don't agree with that. But that's the kind of tactic they applied in a lot of the Soviet countries.
Yeah,
and that's kind of what you see here today as well, with xenophobia, implying that you have an irrational fear. They usually say to persons that are white and who care about their white people and who want to live around their white people, you know, in peace, because they didn't subscribe to what is going on. They don't want this. They're usually ascribed hatred, ascribed fear, you know, feelings they don't claim they possess.
Yeah, well, they're
maybe ascribed these that, voluntarily.
Maybe it's not a, is it a good idea to turn that back against them? Because, you know, the thing is, you can defend on a biological level, just in pure zoology, you can defend a group that defends its own members. That's something that is a biological measure of health. What you would have a very hard time doing in the same fields would be defending members of a group who seek the destruction, annihilation, submersion, subversion, whatever, of their own group. That would be very difficult from an objective perspective to defend. So maybe there's some validity in turning this against, which is kind of what I'm doing. I'm saying that somebody like this lady, I don't want her to be tortured any more than she's already been tortured, too much as it is. I think that she needs to, however, go through a rehabilitation program of self-love, you know, and it's okay to love your own and defend your own. It doesn't mean you have to hate anybody else or refuse to be around them even. But for God's sakes, woman, I mean, if you can't defend your own group, I mean, what good would be a member of a pack of lions or a tribe of lions or whatever, a pack of wolves?
I mean, I think that if she want to live in a multiracial country, I mean, you know, knock yourself out. But don't force on others who don't, you know, voluntarily.
She's not making a distinct position. She's not saying anybody who commits a crime against anyone else is guilty of a hate crime. Yeah. She's not saying that. That would be at least consistent.
Yeah.
She's saying, oh, well, only this group can. You know, only my own pack of wolves.
She's also a cop, so she essentially subscribed to the government and...
Well, maybe in Sweden. I mean, here it's not quite so, not all the time anyway, especially not on a local level. But
yeah,
when they're careful what they say in public, you still, this is pretty extreme, you know. This is very sad. There's a naivety in her brain that has been exploited severely or she's been cultivated in a way that's very detrimental. But, you know, you're basically saying this is my pack of wolves and only they can do bad. But all the other ones, you know, can steal our kills and hunt on our territory.
Well,
and
this goes back to cultural Marxism again. It's the whole idea that whites have power, whites are the dominant group, and as such, we have to give all these other groups more power, more, you know, privileges to counterbalance. That's cultural Marxism. Now, the problem is she, I mean, I don't have a problem if these anti-whites want to do this, you know, on their own. Sure, I mean, go ahead, you know, move to Brazil, have fun, imply your cultural Marxist values. Alternatively, hey, why not, you know, allow you guys to have a part or a segment of the
Yes, I think they should have a segment of Beijing.
No, but even Europe, I mean, even Europe or Sweden, whatever, I don't care, but don't imply it, don't apply this on all of us.
Go to Beijing and convince the police in Beijing that only Chinese can commit hate crimes, and anything Chinese do to a Tibetan or a Japanese person that offends them is a hate crime.
Yeah.
You know, do this in Shanghai or enjoy yourself there. You know, have fun with this. You know, go to Kinshasa and explain that the Congolese are only the hateful people and that anybody else from Kenya or, you know, Ghana or Nigeria or somewhere is not too far away. Ghana's pretty far away. They're the ones that, you know, you need to give all of the rights and privileges to, and only the Congolese Bantu can be hateful. You know, I think she should be sent on a mission around the third world explaining to people how only their own groups are hateful and that everybody else deserves to walk all over them and not be offended. This lady could have, maybe if the therapy doesn't work, we could just say, well, we have to accept that she's like this. Let's just send her abroad and have her, you know, explain this to everyone in their own contexts.
Yeah. By the way, I want to talk a little bit about... some days ago, we talked a little bit about congregation, I believe it was called. Is that the right word?
Aggregation, yeah.
Yeah. And... actually trying to have some kind of a separatist movement or secession, making it explicit on a website or something?
Yeah, and I said I was very much in favor of a voluntary movement towards places that I think will be able to better survive the next 20 years, because I'm not looking at 2050 or 2060, really. I think the next 20 are going to be far more difficult. And a lot of big picture things are going to happen that are going to completely disrupt and basically stop for good the global movement of people and items and services and so forth that we have now. There will still be services because a lot of that's transmitted by wire or wireless. But the global movement of goods and people is going to have to come to a screeching halt, because we're going to have an energy limitation on that. And that's just, that's not going to stop. That's not going away. There's nothing anyone can do to avoid that, you know, and it's going to mean a drastic restructuring of how energy is used. And this is somewhat, it's not beyond issues of racial survival or whatever, ethnic survival. In fact, it can assist them very much, because right now the globalist thing just assumes that it's got enough fuel, or at least if it doesn't have enough, it can still just, you know, use a very much of what it has. And you give it another 20 years, you're not going to have any of that. I mean, you'll have some fuel, but it'll be very much rationed, restricted in use, and sources of it will be fiercely guarded. And you'll also have a lot of times a net negative ability to extract and use, because some things like oil in the tar sands and in the shale and Colorado, you get a net negative on the extraction of it, and there's really no way to get around that. Versus the amount of money you put in, the amount of energy you put into extracting it is more than what you get out of the stuff. And even deep into the process, you've got that, because you've got it at both ends. And so these things are going to affect us severely, but it could be for the better if we move into places that are better able to take care of their own needs and so forth locally.
And okay, so it is not that how can it benefit us? I mean, this knowledge that if assuming it is correct, assuming that this is indeed what is going to happen, how can that benefit those who are prescriptively white?
Well, because we'll be back to a situation where methods of transport and movement are going to require certain technologies that are either like nuclear, which are very expensive, and on both ends of the system don't really give you a whole lot. You get a lot while you're producing it, but you don't get a lot at the beginning. It takes a lot of energy to develop these plans. It takes a lot to decommission them, which people don't look at, because they tend not to look at the end of the problem, or the end of the process, I mean, and that's a problem. But it means that we would be in places where we can take care of each other much better, and we'll be forced to anyway. So in other words, what I'm saying is 20 or 30 years from now, wherever you are, I mean, it's not that people moved around hundreds and thousands of years ago. I mean, people migrated across the earth, but it was much more difficult. It wasn't like you flew in a plane or something, or you took a big ship. You know, it's not to say transportation's all going to stop. It's just not going to be as easy and as frequent and as cheap as it is now, and it's going to be much more time-consuming and time-consuming, basically. It's not going to be any more energy-consuming. It's just the energy's not going to be as available. So, or the fuel, the liquid fuel especially. So, you know, get somewhere you want to be for the long term and where you want your family to be. It's not that nobody can move or they're going to be stuck there permanently. Nobody was stuck there 300 years ago. But you were much more, you know, stable, stationary in terms of your family and the region you lived in.
So are you saying that it's not worthwhile to engage in political issues, or?
It's very worthwhile, because how you position things at the beginning of this is going to affect a lot of how you're able to deal with going through it. So it's very worthwhile. It's, you know, what level of political issues and which ones might, you know, you have to pick your battles wisely in that. I can't, we can get into that later, but
sure.
There's certainly a lot of limitations that we're coming to have to face soon. And of course, you know, the can will get kicked down the road as long as it can. And all these global financial markets will do aerial paper over every problem until the very end. They will do anything they can to manipulate on a non-real level. In other words, on a paper printing level, or even just on a digital money level, a situation that looks like it's not so bad. Yeah. And I'd say probably another 5 or 6 years that can go on. It can be papered over for a little longer than some people think, but ultimately you're going to run into just basic natural limitations on resources, even if the paper game were to work. And so, then it won't work for, I mean, it didn't work in any case that it's ever been tried, and it eventually falls apart. And if it's, you've got a big enough case with the toxic squid that's, you know, got its suction cups on as much of the world as possible, of course it always sucks out of some area where there's a surplus and into an area where there's a deficit, because it's seeking an equilibrium. But I'd say what we ought to do is whites, not to get into too much of an abstract conversation here, but, you know, we just ask for political secession and to grind those arguments is good, because it's, you force a lot of people to show their hypocrisy. But ultimately where our survival is going to lay is with us being in places where we can take care of our own regional and local needs and avoid places where those needs and wants are just too much to deal with the kind of situation will
be. But then my question would be, don't you think it is good to have an explicit movement, such as, for example, the Free State Project?
Yeah, sure.
Where they make it very explicit what their intent is. And as such, for example, now it was founded in 2001, the Free State Project, and the idea is to recruit at least 20,000 libertarian-leaning people.
Right.
And to move then to a single low population state in New Hampshire. And so far, I believe they have 11,000 people that they've gotten added since 2001. I don't know, those numbers are not very great, but I mean, much thanks to their publicity, which they've enabled by having a website and, you know, attempting to marketing this idea, they've actually gotten a lot of like-minded people together in one single area. Do you think this is something that whites should move towards?
Absolutely. You know, make the outside of cities, preferably in areas that have been somewhat, you know, that have had a low population density for a long time, and that aren't, you know, desperately far from industrial centers and cities and so forth, but that are nonetheless mostly rural, and move there with some skills that are wanted and needed by the community.
Yeah.
With some means. I mean, you know, if you just go there to do what there's already too much of going on there to begin with, cattle farming or whatever it might be, then you're probably not going to be very well received because you are going to be a newcomer.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think, you know, here and there people are doing that on an individual level. You know, you see it in the rural parts of the United States, people moving out of cities or at least buying second homes. Many times they're very poorly thought out as far as how their second home is going to actually live through some difficult times. You know, they know, well, I've got a place out in the hills somewhere, but it's still a 4,000 square foot house that requires massive amount of energy, and I'm running off a grid for, I'm totally dependent on the grid, and, you know, the road needs to be plowed long distance for snow and all this. So there's some poor thinking on it, or there's just some assumptions that, well, as long as it's up in the mountains somewhere, it's okay. But it's still, you see it, you know, at least people are thinking here and there, and you have some move toward real legitimate, I don't want to say total self-sufficiency, but increased independence and sufficiency. And you have a lot of localist movements as well in food production and distribution. These are, of course, running into corporate interest with the raw milk issues and the, you know, Monsanto seed problems, where Monsanto's trying to talk about legalese, you know, sue people. They've done this for decades. They've tried it. They've lost a lot, but they're relentless for having seeds blow on their property when these farmers ought to be suing Monsanto. But there are a lot of localist, regionalist movements that aren't even associated with white preservation. Like, many times they're kind of leftist. But nonetheless, demographically and practically, they have a lot of benefit for whoever's participating in them and involved in them.
By the way, if, you know, we're going to upload this to YouTube, obviously, but if you're interested, and if anyone else would be interested, you could go to Wikipedia. And you can actually search for lists of active separatist movements,
right,
and you will find a whole bunch. And I remember I came across a site once that actually had, they had some kind of, they calculated which separatist movement that was most likely to actually succeed in their attempt to secede. And I believe a place called Åland, or as you would say, A-land, which lies between Sweden and Finland, actually. It's in quite a big island. They're very, how should I put it? It seems like they're very able to actually actualize their secession or their desire to secede.
Is this in the Gulf of Bothnia? Kind of south of that in the Baltic?
No, it's actually quite north between Sweden and Finland, kind of.
So it's up in the Gulf of Bothnia?
Do you say, what did you say?
How do you say it? I'm butchering this word. What do you say? How do you call the Gulf up there between Sweden and Finland?
The Gulf. Oh.
The water.
No, it's not there. It's, well, actually, you know.
Oh, it's up in the Arctic?
No. It's in the Baltic. I'll actually look it up.
Okay. Well, I'm just getting a general geographical idea of it.
Sure.
Yeah, that would be good. I mean, and even some, I'd say the biggest success story for anybody, I mean.
But the point is that there actually are several separatist movements.
Mm-hmm.
Not just a few. There's actually several.
Well, I think the greatest separatist success of 2011 was Iceland separating from the IMF largely, you know, and saying, look, we're going to default. I mean, that was kind of 2010, but it was also in 2011. We're not going to take your slavery / austerity / bailout package that much of Europe has been forced into. And of course, Iceland did well as a result, and that's bothered them. So they've tried to punish Iceland economically. Lots of banks have gotten very mad because Iceland basically was showing everybody, hey, this is the way to do it, and it's more successful, and it's better for you. And this is, of course, the last thing that the IMF wants. So as far as separatist movements, there's separation from the governments that you're within, but there are also separations of the governments themselves from internationalist things like the IMF, which are maybe the most wicked and brutal and evil kind of, and I mean that in every sense of the word, forces that are out there. They are absolute, I mean, you know, they are dreadful and destructive, and even lots of people who are on the political left see that.
Yep.
And, you know, that was a very successful secessionist movement from maybe the most significant power that somebody could secede from, I'd say. So Iceland, I have to put up there with is maybe the, you know, if you can secede from the international monetary banking system, which they didn't completely do, but, you know, effectively they did enough.
Yeah.
That's a hell of a successful secession right there. And even encouraging things like that, which are a little bit different than what we're talking about, but they're nonetheless localist, independent, in this case, somewhat nationalist movements. They might not want to phrase it that way, but that's essentially what it is.
Another site that I would like to recommend, by the way, is, let's see if I spelled this correctly. Yes, I did. This site. www.secession.net. And it has a lot of material, and they're obviously... they've obviously read a lot of legal articles and so on and so forth on the matters. The main text on the front page is at least 5,000 racial, ethnic, linguistic, and cultural groups are lumped together into only 189 nation states. Most of the world's violent conflicts are related to struggles for dominance within or independence from some large multinational nation state.
Right.
A large percentage of the world's people, especially in populous India, China, Indonesia, and Africa, would choose to secede from their respective nation states if given the opportunity. Millions of activists worldwide are committed to national, ethnic, religious, and regional secessionist movements, described variously as, and there's a variety of words you can use to essentially explain our views, in a sense, self-determination, independence, autonomy, subnational, micronational, separatist, sovereignty, indigenous, homeland, fourth world, ideological movements explicitly or implicitly promoting individual, community, or regional rights to secession include libertarian, anarchist, anti-authoritarian, decentralist, devolutionist, cantonal, green, bi-regional, quote, small is beautiful, close quote, communal survivalist, radical pacifist, or futurist. While these latter movements may promote different social and economic goals, their commitment to individual liberty is strong. And that's, I think, is important. And Rems Paul mentioned this in one of his videos, where like he laid out the definition of nationalism as he sees it. And I believe many would view nationalism differently if they subscribe to his definition as well. And that is, do you believe different peoples have the right to exist?
There's a broad category that, you know, a lot of people are using now to define, distinguish between two agendas. And one is, you know, the centralization agenda, and one is decentralization.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's other ways you can cut this, and you can look at nuances within both. But regardless, that's pretty clear that there are, you know, there's in evolution, there are these waves and these ebbs and flows of one and the other. And the progress in evolution and the things that make evolution actually move, I would argue, I think anybody would have to, it's almost axiomatic, is that it's decentralization. You know, you don't get an evolutionary move without some sort of divergence. And this is because of the biological and ultimately the chemical and physical nature of all existence. You know, in any kind of chemical reaction, you know, you have a reduction of the chemical potential. And that keeps on going up the line, even into complex systems. You can't avoid that. It's innate in physicality. And so I think that the push towards decentralization, which there again, you have many that are quote unquote on the left, but they're really not, because the deep fundamental assumptions of the left are centralization, they're centralist. And this is why many big powerful capitalists got so behind many communist movements, the Rockefellers and so forth, and foundations like theirs and Carnegie, after Carnegie, Andrew was dead, of course, but nonetheless with his name on it, started pushing all of these universalist kind of movements. And now it's funny because many people who are adherents to that are still like the certain sides of that have very much taken up the cause of local, regional decentralization in general. I've never heard some of these terms. I'm not sure I would use the word devolutionist, because really what you're talking about is evolution.
Yeah.
Because evolution is towards, I think somebody's doesn't understand evolution here maybe, but you know, it's it's a divergent phenomenon. This is how you get distinction, and this is why you have markers that all of a sudden show up in the SNP markers in the genome.
And yeah, but I agree with you completely.
You can push decentralization amongst people who are not necessarily immediately receptive to at least white ethnic survival, yeah, although they still beat other groups for various reasons we've discussed. They've, you know, got some hypocrisy there, but you got at least an in with them and saying, okay, but you're still a decentralist. You're still somebody who's for, you know, local, small is better, communal, regional. And yeah, I think that's a very fruitful place to interact with people, certainly in day-to-day life. Because I mean, most of the people I run into out, you know, outside of, you know, some of the discussions I have with some friends, you know, I don't even get into a lot of stuff that I talk to you here about, because it's going to turn them off and they're going to think, oh, this guy is a totally different person, you know, even though I'm not. So I find things that I relate to them on. And certainly decentralization is one that I've found almost unanimous support for, except with certain people who feel that they have a political stance. There's an element of liberals. I have some in my own family who will support centralization at all costs because they think this is the more reasonable and rational way to do it. It's the easier path. It's the path of least resistance to them is what it boils down to. And so they like this. But far more often I see people who will agree that decentralization is what we need now. And you've had this move towards, you know, coagulation. I said aggregation and congregation before. Now I say, in kind of with a negative or a pejorative bit of connotation, I will say coagulation of world power, resources, and so forth. And that now needs to break up. That thing kind of just needs to break up into lots of little bits and pieces. And whether it's the more the better or not, in all cases, it needs to break up severely, because we've got a massive reduction reaction going on. It's not reduction in a sense of electron exchange, but it's a reduction of chemical potential kind of thing going on. And now there needs to be some active effort to distinguish within that and segment and partition and then break up. I'm, you know, speaking very general, vague terms somewhat, but it's the drive behind that thinking is just the physical nature of existence being understood and then applied to all systems above them. You know, it's kind of like what I've in the past tried to get in discuss with the second law of thermodynamics and then active partitioning, which is what distinguishes complexity, which is what allows for complexity. So you have a push towards entropy and towards you know, equalization or equilibrium, but you also have within that active components that then seek to distinguish and diverge. And yeah, that's a rather interesting thing, but it's what allows for complexity to exist. So if you want, if you, you know, want to have, you know, the kind of physical, very physical evolution that we've had for a long time, or let's say evolution from a very physicalist perspective, then you need to have that. Otherwise, you will have human society and everything reduced over time to a very disgusting and stifling sameness, which nobody really wants. And the elite who push that, of course, consider themselves as the only ones who deserve to be divergent. Yeah. This is their kind of idea. Well, we in our little small group, there's not 1%. It's like 0.0001%. You know, one in every million or 10 million people in the world, which is who holds real ability to manipulate a lot of resources. You know, would like they agree with that, but they think they're the only ones who deserve to be part of this divergent group that can then submerge everybody else in this stifling sameness and then use the gradient potential between the two, if they're even that smart to think of it like that, is some source of power
to make one poor class, working class, and then one elite, making two classes instead of three or several, increasing the gap.
You have a gradient potential, you know, where you have a big gradient of power difference or concentration difference. So that's their idea. You have, you know, a world of 6 billion some people, and most of them you would put in as far down as you possibly can, and you will use them against each other to do that, because they will all try to seek an equilibrium. At least the masses amongst them will, and the 30% or 40% of them that don't, or 10% of them that really try not too hard, you try to get rid of, or you make them very scared to push their thing, and you use that other 70, 80, whatever percent against them, or 60, and then you put yourself at the top of this, you know, 1/1000th of a percent or 1/10000th of a percent or something like that. And now you have this huge difference between the two. I don't know if they look at it like that, but it does seem to be what they're moving towards or trying to do. And, you know, that there again is an argument that is not specific to white ethnic survival or European survival. Applies to everybody, but it's a good way of looking at things. At least I think it's very helpful, and it can predict a lot and explain a lot.
By the way, you talked about devolution before, because they mentioned the word evolution, and yeah, I definitely agree with what you have to say, that it's rather the opposite. It's rather evolution, I would say, in divergence, because you're essentially allowing for natural selection to occur. You know, you're not opposing people to opt out if they so desire. You're not opposing genetic drift. On the contrary, you're allowing for it.
You're stimulating it.
Yeah, exactly.
This is our stimulus package, okay?
Yeah, so, I mean, Kaiser, for example, Kaiser et al., 2005, he investigated actually the Darwinian function of borders, for example. And I mean, if you create a lot of secessionist movements, and these secessionist movements are actually allowed to break free from the former nations and form several mini nations, what you essentially have is you have created a form of the I don't know if it's an island model or bottleneck or whatever, but the borders essentially function as a protector, which allows for genetic drift to occur within that border. And I mean, that is evolution, rather than forcing everyone into the same mold. And, you know,
it's not just genetic drift, it's actually selection.
Yeah.
Drift is kind of a random way. It's a good standard candle to use in evolution to use against.
Well, if white select for a white place,
Right. It's
then they will genetically drift. And that's evolution. That's not full selection. Yeah.
It's not a walk. It's a limit cycle, if you want to use the chaos analogy.
Yeah. By the way, there's something else I wanted to show you, but the link is too long for me to write here. I have it on paper. Something called Essay, School Papers, International Position of Secession. That's also quite interesting. And I also want to talk a little bit shortly here about, on YouTube, have you encountered an individual that goes by the nickname Red Shirt Army?
Yes, the Southern Secession, yes, the South, Southern Nationalist.
Yeah, because I would recommend him to anyone who...
I like him very much.
Yeah, he seems like a very cool guy. He's very informed on the topic. The
gym, but I like him.
Huh?
He needs to hit the gym a little bit, but...
Yeah. Then there's... because he has a video called The Principle of Secession, where he quotes Mises, Ludwig von Mises, Spooner, and Molinari. And Ludwig von Mises actually have very positive things to say regarding secession, which are quite interesting. So for anyone, if you didn't know that, now you know, and you can look into it, and I would recommend anyone to look into it. And these are, it's quotes like these, which I will read soon, that we can draw validity from, we can draw moral strength from, I believe.
Yes, I agree. And there's, we have a broad association of at least compatible interests out there.
Yeah.
And I think this exists, that, you know, when you allow your own group to be defined, you want to be careful that you're not too broad, that you start to encompass too much, that you can't, that you have strange bedfellows and all this kind of thing can happen. But you also want to have different levels of a hierarchy of partitions.
Yeah.
And that way, you know, you also have association with other groups who have compatible agendas and who, even though on some points may be very difficult for you to agree with, you know, or they may find it very difficult for them to agree with you. They may even, you know, not like you even. You have to kind of be very cautious about what you say off the bat. There's still broad points of agreement or very strong points of agreement,
yeah,
that you don't want to avoid using. You don't want to lose that, because you can say, hey, guys, you know, we understand that maybe you don't agree with us all on these things yet. That's fine, but you do over here, and this is very important to us as well.
And that's actually something I wanted to talk about at a later date.
A strategy of partition hierarchy, right?
Yeah, no, but do you want to talk about race, or do you just want to talk about liberty? Is it necessary to talk about race?
Talking about, we'll go into it a little bit. I think there's lots of things. I want to talk about lots of things, and we can draw conclusions that apply to us with the concern about our own people's survival.
Yeah.
And prosperity, not just survival, but survival in a decent way, in a way that actually allows us to realize our potentials, and not to be against others, but certainly not to have others against us in a way that causes us not to realize what we are capable of, you know. And I think everybody wants this for their own people too. And when you understand the nature of evolution and race, you understand that this is something that nature wants as well. And there's nothing hateful or destructive about it. Nope. And certainly these things have come into conflict for, you know, long through human history. But now, because we're in a place where there's so much, so many people on the planet, we've got to come up with some very wise strategies that reduce the amount of conflict that has been, you know, there in the past. And you have to be honest with these things in order to do that. You can't.
That's the insanity. It's so strange for me to that people do not see that forcing people together when they don't want it to be together, that is going to cause compromises. That is going to cause tensions.
The agenda was written by people who wanted to cause tensions. I mean, I think it's very hard for a lot of people who will state that they don't want these kinds of tensions, and then they will want a policy of systems that cause these tensions, or a system of policies that cause these tensions, and you say, guys, you've got a cognitive disconnect here. There's some dissonance going on.
Well, I'm primarily thinking about not necessarily the thinkers behind it, but
right.
the promoters, like
right, exactly, the useful idiots,
liberals in general.
That's right, the useful idiots who completely are in contradiction with their own stated goals, in terms of they just don't recognize certain things as inevitable if you put a certain arrangement together. They say, oh yes, but I'm going to put that arrangement together and everybody's just going to say it's good and it's going to work. It's like, no, it won't, because you've got problems here. You don't build a house like that. You certainly don't build a bridge like that. You don't build a plane like that. Why would you try to build a society like that? It's like, well, I want the wing to face this direction. Well, then the plane's not going to fly, dude.
But the thing is,
better just make it fly.
But the thing is, we can use against them. We can use quotes like these. I'm just going to use a very short one by Ludwig von Mises, and this is in his Liberalism, at page 119. The situation, and of course, he refers to classical liberalism, not liberalism as we know it today, which are two very different things. The situation of having to belong to a state to which one does not wish to belong is no less onerous, I don't know if that's right. If it is the result of an election, then if one must endure it as the consequence of a military conquest.
Right.
And that's kind of how I feel. He goes on to say in another, here's another quote, Nation, State, and Economy, page 34, no people and no part of a people shall be held against its will in a political association that it does not want. At page 3940, he says, liberalism knows no conquest, no annexations, just as it is indifferent towards the state itself. So the problem of the size of the state is unimportant to it. It forces no one against his will into the structure of the state. Whoever wants to emigrate is not held back. When a part of the people of the states wants to drop out of the union, liberalism, of course, again, referring to classic liberalism, does not hinder it from doing so. Colonies that want to become independent need only do so. The nation as an organic entity can be neither increased nor reduced by changes in states. The world as a whole can neither win nor lose from them. And here's another one. Let's see here. The right of self-determination in regard to the question of membership in a state thus means, whenever the inhabitants of a particular territory, whether it be a single village, a whole district, or a series of adjacent districts, make it known by a freely conducted plebiscite that they no longer wish to remain united to the state to which they belong at the time, but wish either to form an independent state or to attach themselves to some other state, their wishes are to be respected and complied with. This is the only feasible and effective way of preventing revolutions and civil and international wars. To call this right of self-determination the, quote, right of self-determination of nations, close quote, is to misunderstand it. It is not the right of self-determination of a delimited national unit, but the right of the inhabitants of every territory to decide on the state to which they wish to belong. And I think we can use a lot of the end quote, by the way.
He's doing an interesting thing. He's applying a majority rule thing, which can cause problems when you draw your boundaries too wide. You know, this is why you have the federal government in a lot of cases stepping in and telling states they have to do it this way, that way, or even counties or cities. But what he's saying is no. Majority rule applies to a very local area. So if this geography here wants to do this, the majority in there wants to do it, this is okay. You can't now draw a larger boundary around an area that's 3,000 by 2,000 square miles, or 3,000 by 2,000 miles or whatever, and say, okay, all you guys within here have to go along with the majority of this grand region. He's basically applying the majority rule thing in a way that I actually like it.
Yes.
Because he'll say, okay, if this county wants to do its own thing, they may have consequences as far as, in relations with neighboring counties and counties beyond, but this is up to them. And this will force a lot of, I also think that ultimately that's going to be the situation that is actually in existence probably 20 to 30 years from now because of energy limitations or the resources of global movement and travel and distribution being severely curtailed by a lack or in almost an effective absence of liquid fuel. And so, you know, that will be a situation. Von Mises will get his way with that. Now, what it looks like before there and how dirty that whole process is, I'm sure he wouldn't want to see, because it's not going to be nice, given the assumptions people have with what they've got. They like, they don't want to lose, they don't want to get rid of. You know, they think it's non-negotiable, but it's not. Nature is the final arbiter, and that's a very much more natural kind of, you know, arrangement. That may not be as small as he wants. The thing that I like about him is it's not just like the ancient days where you just have tribes and bands that, you know, had small territories and they might have fought at the borders or married at the borders. You know, he's saying, okay, we need to come out and explicitly define this and make it workable with a very complex and complex society with a large population.
Yeah.
And, you know, over a large geography, that's going to be the case. And so it's not exactly the situation you had, say, you know, 5,000-10,000 years ago in most of the world, or even, you know, more recently than that in parts of the world. It's a much more sophisticated way of looking at it. I very much like that. I'm also very impressed you quoted from page 3,094. I've never read a 3,000-page book before in my life. Well, read 3,000 pages, but not the same book. I didn't know he wrote one. That's huge.
By the way, I also want to quote, because I know you have to leave soon, I just want to quote this as well, because I want to include this in the video, because it's kind of related to what we've been talking about, but there's never been a chance to really include this in the talks earlier. Let's see here. This is a quote by Malcolm Fraser in regards to what genocide is. Genocide involves the attempt to achieve the disappearance of a group by whatever means. It does not have to be violent. It could be a combination of policies that would lead to a certain group dying out. And I mean, isn't that essentially what we are seeing today?
Of course.
Yeah. And then we have another here by a quote by legal scholar Raphael Lemkin, who actually termed or coined the term genocide. This is 1943. He says, generally speaking, genocide does not necessarily mean the immediate destruction of a nation, which many people obviously assume, except when accomplished by mass killings of all members of a nation. It is intended rather to signify a coordinated plan of different actions aiming at the destruction of essential foundations of the life of national groups, with the aim of annihilating the groups themselves. The objectives of such a plan would be the disintegration of the political and social institutions of culture, language, national feelings, religion, and the economic existence of national groups, and the destruction of personal security, liberty, health, dignity, and lives of the members of such groups. And again, I believe we can actually point to popular culture, we can point to institutions, bureaucracy, and show that indeed what we can observe today in modern society can or does fit the definition of genocide, according to Raphael Lemkin, what he would consider it to be. Now, whether it's a plan or not, I don't know, but I mean, if you know that political policies are detrimental,
yeah,
and it can be shown that they are,
right,
and they are still pursued, I mean, couldn't it be argued that it is at least known?
Yes, everybody doesn't have to have a absolutely explicit agreement to a certain end in order
exactly
to be achieving a certain end.
Exactly.
I did not know that Raphael Lemkin was the guy that coined the term genocide. I thought, you know, well, it just kind of grew out of homicide, fratricide, suicide, matricide, whatever, genocide. But that's good. And on that note, that's pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
The guy who coined the term genocide first that we know of agrees with you. And
yeah, essentially.
Us.
So that's really beneficial. Yeah, but I mean, we're obviously going to talk on Skype more. What we're going to talk about at the later point, what we're going to talk about, I don't know. Maybe we've
done a lot of research. You have maybe give me a research assignment, because you've done a tremendous amount of quoting from sources. I've done zero, so that's you've done awesome.
Well, I know you're busy with studying and...
Yeah, well, if I can... I'll work it in.
Okay. Sure, I can give you some stuff on secession and so on, because I find that quite interesting. And as you said earlier, I mean, you consider it to be worthwhile to simultaneously be working for some kind of, what was it called, congregation, people voluntarily moving to an area while simultaneously promoting liberty, and actually perhaps marketing.
Yes, the marketing is about divergence and aggregation and how to use the human brain to the advantage of the human potential, which is, you know, not the same thing as trying to reduce everybody to some kind of suffocating sameness.
Yeah, promoting global diversity in a sense.
As in a real sense.
Which includes whites, which includes
absolutely
indigenous French, indigenous Italians, yes, indigenous Swedes. So on that note, should we end the Skype?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Nice talking to you.
Yeah, you too.
And,
I'll be
care.
Back tomorrow.
Bye.
Later.
Pushing me around.